responsibility. I'm not the creative lead, but I'd like to think so. But you have to curb that. Is that a lesson that can be taught?
Yeah, absolutely. We spend a lot of time talking about working with difficult people and managing, that deflect, defer, and so forth with different personalities. And because our program has international students, we were talking about that earlier, as well as mature students, I have people who, brilliant ideas and fairly far down the process, and I have a 17-year-old straight out of high school, and they're on the same team. And the 17-year-old kind of wants to drink and go back to the dorm and have fun and hand the assignment in at the very last second, if at all. And the 35-year-old who's been working for 10 years and is serious wants to get the most, and they have to find a way to work together. So we spend a lot of time in class on that.
Wow. Mm-hmm. I think that sounds like the toughest aspect of your job right now.
Yes.
What do you think of that?
I feel like one of the major points that both of them have connected to is discipline, right? Is the filmmakers or the aspiring filmmakers' discipline and their course in learning, and so I feel like what Raindance at least tries to provide in that aspect is they're. People aren't forced into a 2 or 3 year program necessarily. It might be 5, might be 10 years over time where they've taken a number of different screenwriting courses over time to be able to continually develop their art, but maybe their concentration is on another career or a second career that they're actually doing, or a primary career, and they're only starting out as a hobbyist, but they're slowly developing that screenwriting skill so that over time they're gonna get to maybe where somebody would be after 2 years of traditional film school. Again, I think that's, I think we're trying to create sort of that adaptability towards how, so that people can have different disciplines on their approach to learning. Whereas some people might be intimidated by the fact that they're doing a short program of learning and mm-hmm. how
to
do that.
And that they have to sort of cram everything in. Kathilee, you went to Ryerson, mm-hmm. and while you were a student there, what did you perceive yourself to be at this moment in your life when you were looking ahead?
When I was looking ahead, wow. Coming out of Ryerson, I think I thought I would go into a job just like my parents had done and stay in that job for my entire career and build a career. And instead, what has happened, like many of us, is I've built my own career, my own businesses, freelance. I've never really had that job with the briefcase, the walk into the office kind of, mm-hmm. That I imagined I would have when I went to film school.
Did you see yourself, though, as a director? Did you want to make film? Or mm-hmm. Let me just present this to everyone at the mm-hmm. table. Is it hard to get students to realize that maybe they're not meant to be a director, that maybe they could be better served as in another aspect in the filmmaking world?
I definitely think so. I think a lot of the makeup of the people we see at Raindance are not just the young aspiring filmmaker kind of person, but are a lot of older sort of second career professionals as well, too, right? That they want to move towards a career in filmmaking like I did. I actually came from working in the corporate world and working in finance and working as a business analyst. And I decided to transition when I started to connect with Raindance as an organization and doing my own courses and realized that, hey, this is a way that I can do my side learning to start as I continue in my primary career. And then I saw this progression in my work, that I was able to develop my own projects, develop my own financing, and start doing my own shorts. And so sort of that progression that I guess some people is, that's what film school is for, but I've been able to chart my own path in order to do it.
It sounds like if you were to think about your trajectory, that you would become like a studio head, although I don't think we see studio heads like we used to, because you were talking about earlier, Michael, having somebody at the studio sending back your script. Mm-hmm. My thought when you said that at the time was, wouldn't it be great if these studio heads could actually take the time and learn these things?
Yeah.
But that would be an impossible feat.
It's not impossible. You need to have the skill set to actually respond to a project in a creative way.
Right. Oh, I think, to tell a studio head that they need that skill set.
Oh, that's hard to do.
Yeah, that was
sure.
Hard to
do. Oh, yeah, definitely. Sure. I mean, that career path is so wide and varied that someone who goes up there who knows money really well but maybe not creative, right. But if they surround themselves with the right creative people, that's usually what happens. I mean, previously to my Ryerson career, I was at the CBC and at Alliance Communications Corporation, and you would often find an exec who maybe didn't have such a great creative sense, may not admit it, but would certainly surround herself or himself with people who knew how to read a script and, you know, and have a collaborative discussion about it. So I think, from my experience, I think anyone who goes into a position of gatekeeping or a CEO of a big studio or something like that who believes they have a creative sense but doesn't won't last very long.
Okay. And, well, and there are. I mean, in the golden age of Hollywood, there were a lot of studio exec changes. I mean, right through the 70s and 80s, too. What do you tell students about that experience, Kathilee, about dealing with people who may be in charge of the money, but may be making some bad decisions on your behalf?
Well, it's one of the things, one of the courses I teach is career planning, so we talk a lot about this kind of stuff, how you choose what you want and why and where you think your goals may be. And one of the issues we bring up a lot is that if you think you want to produce or production manage or direct, then you're likely going to have to deal with a whole other side of the business. And if your skills, if your people skills aren't great, you may want to reconsider whether that's a career option for you, because it always is taking that criticism, taking that input, whether you agree with it or not, and figuring out what you're going to do with it and how you're going to manage it, depending on who owns the purse strings at that moment.
You know, I have heard stories from screenwriters, Stanley Mann, for example, who wrote the screenplay for The Collector, which you might remember has a very bleak ending, and the studio's wanting him to change it. So they gave them, Stanley Mann and producers gave the studio head a different script, and they filmed the movie that we now see and got away with it. I mean, these kind of tricks make for great sort of legends and stories. Can you really get away with that in the real world, or you have to be a Stanley Mann to get away with that?
I don't know if it's possible these days. I guess, I don't know if it's still the term that's being used, but a final cut director, meaning that director gets final cut. I know David Cronenberg used to get final cut when we worked at Alliance, but he was one of the few who ever did. That just doesn't happen anymore. I think in today's movie era as well, where you've got a decline in people going to movies, and you've got serialization of movies, and Marvel runs the show these days typically in the box office, it's very hard to sneak one in. You know, television is now the realm where you're finding darker endings and a lot of stuff that can happen that may be a bit off the cuff, you know. And you're seeing a lot of people who were in, say, to dark, edgy films now gravitating to television, and audiences are responding. So I think you might be able to get away with it there, but it's so expensive, it's so time-consuming, there's so much competition for audiences out there. I just don't see how anyone's not going to have oversight on everything that happens.
Keep a close eye on it.
Which is not a bad thing. I mean, but there's a lot of trust that goes into these creators, the showrunners for the television shows or the filmmakers. Once you've championed someone, you know they've got passion and you know that they're going to be great. You stand back. The best ones stand back and get out of the way and let them make what they're going to do.
The best producers stand back?
The best execs. I mean, the best people who control the money. You know, I don't just want to say control the money, but who control the greenlighting process, you know. It's in my experience, they tend to be the ones who would say, I've put this money and this time and this passion into you and your project, and if they get in the way, you know, what are they doing? I mean, they're not allowing the creativity to come out. They're not, and don't forget that these things take years to develop. I mean, years and years to get actually into a pilot for television or onto screen as a film. So along the way, if anyone starts to interfere with the creative makeup of a show, it's going to start to degrade the process, and people are going to back out of it, and it won't get any further. But there are times when, say, a show is gone for a season. In Canada, this happens sometimes too, where there's a showrunner who's worked it through the first season, and then they bring in another showrunner for the second season, and then you see the show kind of dismantle and lose its vision, right? That happens more regularly than you'd like. And you can see that's an example of how bringing someone else in to disrupt the initial creative vision can often be a detriment to the original passion of the project. I don't know if that answers your question or
not. Well, it does, and it brings up another question. And I don't know how this question sort of fits in everything, but we're talking about television shows, and sometimes they extend themselves too long. They start jumping the shark. And you mentioned that Rain Dance started in UK. The UK kind of has a system with television where it's no more than 13 episodes mm-hmm. of right. any given mm-hmm. show.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And then the show is a different show again.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That doesn't happen in North America mm-hmm. all that often. Is that
I would say part of that is, you know, for the UK, at least in my experience and seeing how they do things there, is their business model and how they do the productions, right? And because there's such a break sometimes in between one series and the next series, or seasons, or there it's,
yeah.
it's called series, that they decide during that time, we want to redevelop a bit of what it is, right? And that's why you might see the changes in between, right? What I was going to say a little bit to the point of what Michael was mentioning was that I think that's very accurate towards how the North American industry is sort of structured, right? But, you know, I've been lucky enough to connect with a lot of filmmakers internationally that do TV series as well in China and in Indonesia and other Asian countries. And some of those productions are actually even produced here in Canada mm-hmm. And then sent back over there. And so I think there's a lot of emerging models that allow for a free space for filmmakers to not necessarily have to answer to executives in the same way, mm-hmm. to not have to answer to the studios or the broadcasters in the same way. And I think it's in some of those developments that I guess like alternative film school tries, for at least the way we're sort of set up with different hubs all over the world, try to connect with how can we connect you with this industry over here, mm. right, in this other country, and develop your projects in a way that you want to.
It sounds like film schools and people like Kathleen and Michael, that there could be a merger here of some sort cooperation.
Absolutely.
I'm not forcing you guys to be friends or anything, but, I like the idea again that you're shaping ideas, you're shaping a community of filmmakers. We're not teaching people to be auteurs anymore, are we? That's gone by the wayside.
I mean, it's interesting because I was thinking when you were talking, I think all the time how much I envy my students to be going into our industry at this time. They're all quite scared because they hear all the doom and gloom and mm-hmm. there's not enough work and it's in trouble. But the creative process for them is so free. You know, when I went through Ryerson, you know, we were literally learning how to cut the tape still, and we needed all these machines that you didn't have. They can sit down with their iPhone 7 and their laptop and make anything, mm-hmm. right, in a way that we couldn't. And there are all these new venues opening up for them for their work to be seen.
Right.
You know, we're currently at home really into the new stuff that's coming from Korea, the 10-minute shorts, right?
Right,
the series. And it's, I was just talking about it with my students, going, look, there's a whole new world that 10 years ago, 10-minute drama series, where would that air,
right?
Right?
Exactly.
And now there's a market for this, and they can create it. It's
wow.
very exciting.
Right. Right. Well, you know, and the name of this show is Making Movies the Canadian Way. Is there a Canadian way to make movies?
It's called funding. It's called telefilm.
Yeah, exactly.
It's called the CMF.
We will be talking to those people, mm-hmm. Both of them.
That's, yes. You know, I do. That is a process. But to what you're saying, mm-hmm. there's the breaking down of the barriers between creator and audience is happening at a rapid pace now, mm-hmm. which is it's astonishing, and it's really invigorated a lot of the industry. Mm-hmm. But the core does come back to, that's great that you can do all this on your laptop with your iPhone. But what's the story? Mm-hmm. If there's one thing that screenwriters will tell you, that's a great project, nicely crafted, looks great, mm-hmm. what's the point? You know, mm-hmm. what's the story? What are you trying to say with this? And if you don't know, then you've got to go back to the drawing board, because the audience's takeaway has to be something more than stunning visuals and things like that.
Right.
You know, it always is fascinating. I'm sorry, did you want to add something?
I was just only going to say, you know, that I think that's a great point. I mean, I think a lot of the message of what Raindance has tried to promote, but generally the independent world has tried to promote, is that, you know, we don't have to go through the gatekeepers. You don't have to go through the studios. You can do your own projects, like the auteurs, right? I think that the idea of how technology has advanced and how people can get their work out there, whether it's on the internet or through apps or things like that these days, there's so much more access to the technology to be able to make your film and distribute your film.
Mm-hmm.
The question is, with what Michael was saying, is how do you make the money off of it? How do you make mm-hmm. it a career out of it? And I think that's still the big struggle for a lot of people on that level, even though now we can, independent filmmakers can make the content and get it out there, how do you still get people to see it and how do you monetize it? And that's still, I think, the larger struggle that's existed.
But you seem more positive about that.
Yeah, I absolutely, because I think that there is a new model, and the old model, I think most of us, be interesting to hear what your funding people say, but as an independent producer, I will tell you the old Canadian model has been broken for quite a while, mm-hmm. and we've all been struggling to kind of cobble it together, and I know when I talk to my students about it, I say, I'm going to talk to you about what kind of elements are come together to make a film happen, as opposed to go to this place for this fund and this is the way the process works, because mm-hmm. from one year to the next, it changes completely.
Wow.
Right?
Yeah.
And so it's about giving them the skill set that they need to manage whatever's coming next. And back to that whole social, emotional, flexibility, resilience, self-regulation, mm. those are the kind of things sure. that these young filmmakers are going to need to figure out how to work in our industry.
Is there a course called the psychology of a filmmaker where they have to learn the mindset of this business? I mean,
yeah, it's called comedy writing.
Yeah,
I actually teach a course in comedy writing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And everybody's scared. Mm-hmm. It's an elective, so they're all there and they want to be there. But the first day of the class, I slam the door shut and I say, forget who's outside that door. You're now in this room to make each other better writers. And I make them take a pledge, and they swear that they agree to be offended at some point in this class, culturally, racially, gender, whatever it is, they're going to be offended by the comedy that comes out of this room. And you're going to voice it if you do, but you're also going to be open to it, because comedy is that edgy art that does it. And psychologically speaking, you go into some pretty dark areas. This may not answer your question entirely, but I prepped them for the fact that they're going to use each other to bounce the ideas off of and fall flat on their faces. And they come out of that course with, I think, some real resilience. Because by the time we're done, we're doing table reads of each other's spec sitcoms. They do stand-up in front of the group. And they are allowed to fall flat, and they're allowed to not laugh. And that's really the ultimate judge of whether that writing is working or not. So they are surprised by that process. Speaking to the resiliency, they think, I got into this school, it was really competitive to get in there. I did it with my goal-based learning from high school that I learned, what's my grade? But they come out of a course like that, and hopefully our school does that in many different courses, where they realize it's not about the grade, it's about me putting myself out there, getting the confidence to actually tell my story and find my voice.
You know, and the confidence and putting yourself out there is so important. You began our conversation by suggesting that the parents are the ones who say, yeah. people perhaps who are flipping the bill.
The funders,
the
money people. Yeah,
are saying, is this worth it?
Yeah.
Basically suggesting that maybe most parents don't want their children to be in this industry. So having the courage to actually do it is a huge step, isn't it? To actually believe that it can be done, and I mean, you know, we talked to Art Hindle the other day, who said that he was a stockbroker, a very successful one, had three kids at 20. I can't figure that one out, but had three kids, gave it up to become an actor, and now look where his career is. But there's a huge risk in this, and now with people saying that the industry is. I like it better when they say the industry is changing. Mm-hmm. Some people saying the industry is disappearing. I don't think that's true, but you know, how do you encourage continual growth in the in your students or with your students?
Well, for us, often on a board level, we have discussions about if someone was to come through Raindance, what is their pathway through the organization, right? Whether it's building the network, taking courses, or what is it that's going to take them from point A to point B? Mm-hmm. And we're not directly self-stylizing for every individual, but we're trying to create the opportunities for them to self-stylize by looking at the curriculum, looking at the events that we hold, and all that kind of stuff, and move towards the direction that they'd like to move in. We felt like that was this approach is the best way in order to provide them, to be responsive to the changing nature of the industry, mm-hmm. right? And I think that's why we also try to attract instructors that aren't people just in a place of being like academic and teaching, but also like they're working on a production. So they're working on a production on Monday and Tuesday. They're coming to teach a class on Wednesday, and they're away Thursday, Friday, because they're going to provide real experience and allow the people who are developing that very real experience on the way they can go.
Do all the students have an opportunity to work in the field at some point before, as part of
internship.
Their course training?
Yeah.
Internship?
Yeah, for sure.
We do an internship, and ours is project-based. So they do a team documentary. They have to come up with, everyone pitches a documentary, only 12 of them go into production. Then the next semester, everyone pitches a short drama, only 9 of them go into production, and they have to form their own teams and go through the process of creating a project, and then they do an internship at the end. Right. So it's very much hands-on, and I think we're all saying that. I don't think the years of teaching film as a theory, where you sat in class and watched film and tried to analyze them and break them down and talk about it, is long gone.
It's still perception, though. I think that permeates out there, right? And so when I talk about the criticism too, I'm not saying I'm critical of traditional film school. I'm just saying that's the perception of a lot of the people that we connect with too at Raindance, and because they're coming to Raindance, it's not our job to demystify the traditional film school. But we do connect to say, oh, you know, this is when people are talking, saying, oh, I'd like to learn more about some film theory or film history. We say, well, right now we're not really teaching that at Raindance. Yeah. You know, that's sort of maybe your more traditional film school. You get a little bit more of that. But now, we've actually created a couple courses that are going to start running to do that, just because there's been so much demand of people who have not done film school and would like to understand more.
You're probably getting the sense that all three of us are teaching more experiential learning than chalk and talk or screen and talk type shows.
Exactly.
I mean, that's not how students like to learn. That's not the way we like to teach.
No.
For us at Ryerson, we have a lot of experiential areas for students to go into now with zone learning. This is a big thing in Ontario now, and also we have a digital media zone at Ryerson. We have something called the Transmedia Zone, where students and from all different parts of Ryerson can come in, and they can design something that they want to do iteratively right there and go through several iterations right in this zone that they've got, which is basically a big room with a lot of technology in it and a lot of tables where they can sit and collaborate in some whiteboards and literally spitball stuff with other people from other programs and come up with a project at the end of it. It could be a piece of technology, it could be a story, it could be anything. And we're really moving towards that as a university, and particularly as a faculty, because RTA is part of a larger faculty that includes the film school, which is called Image Arts, and includes 9 schools in total, including fashion and graphic design. So we've got these hubs. We actually call ourselves a hub now, FCAD, the Faculty of Communication Design, is now a hub of creativity, where we've got all these different schools who used to be siloed, now cross-pollinating in different zones or different areas or studios, mashing their talents together and coming up with some really cool stuff. Why wouldn't someone who's going to put something on screen bring someone in from fashion to help do the design of the thing? You know, that's the kind of thinking that we're doing. And to get back to your original question, to say, how do we keep these students continually trying to grow? That's one of the ways, is to expand their mind to think, I can use that person's creativity in my project, and they can benefit from this creative collaboration. And it really works well. And it's not that, let's screen a movie and talk about how the lighting worked in that one. You know,
that's what I love.
I know you do. I'm hearing this, and I'm thinking that's. There's room for that, let's do the lighting first, and then maybe look at Casablanca after and say how they did it. You know.
Yes, because there's nothing worse than having someone say, I don't like that lighting, you know, or like the person
said, why don't you like
them, and not being able to answer that.
Yeah. Exactly.
Or someone who, a young filmmaker coming up with a film that he or she thinks is completely creative and completely original, and you're just going, oh man, that is Tarantino. That is, you know, like, or even Preston Sturges or Frank Capra. Right. There is value in the.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. I mean,
don't say that just to make me feel good.
No, there is.
Trying to say that. Yeah. Definitely not. I mean, like, if you know the context within your within from whence you came, right? The artist that knows the art that came before him or her. Right. That's absolutely necessary, I think. And I think anyone who's a major filmmaker or a showrunner these days can describe to you what their show is really about in terms beyond audience numbers and things like that. Chris Carter once described The X-Files as a Renaissance show. And he described Mulder and Scully as this unrequited Renaissance couple, or not Renaissance, this romantic relationship. And of course, the interviewer said, "Oh, you mean they're in love?" He said, "No, I mean like in the romantic period when they pined for each other but never really got together." And so here's Chris Carter making The X-Files, this sci-fi show, very well read, knows all the stuff you're talking about, has watched the films, has watched all the classic art that came before him and is able to articulate that in his series.
Yes.
So that's crucial.
And like George Lucas saying the Star Wars is a Western and all these sorts of things. Yeah. I have two more questions I want to get out. One of them is going to be a favorite Canadian film, and I'm going to save that one for last. So even while you're answering the next question, I know you're going to be thinking, oh, which film am I going to say? But can you, when a student walks into the room, can you say almost right away, that person has something?
You know, it's interesting, because I'll jump in first. Sometimes, absolutely, you can kind of pick the stars right away. But sometimes they're such a pleasant surprise. And I love the career planning class I take. We do a goal planning thing, but it's less about, it's a very personal exercise for them. And they're allowed to create this assignment, the last assignment they do for me, in any way they want. So people do board games, and they do videos and film, and it's all different for each student. And last year, it really struck me, because I had a student who had an anger management problem all the way through our program, and we dealt with it and talked about it because we're in these project teams all the way through. And then I got their goal plan, and it was a film about where they grew up and how difficult their life situation was, and how they didn't know how they were going to pay the rent and keep food on the table for their little sister while they were going to school, and the abuse that was happening, and all this backstory that I knew nothing about before. And suddenly they became so much more of a superstar than they were before. And there was no way for me to have known that originally. So I think, I'm sure for both of you too, as a teacher, that's my biggest challenge. How do I find that? How do I find that connection early on with that student so I can help bring out the best in them while they're with us, or at least support where they need the support?
Right, and I guess the other side of that question is you can't be, and to your answer, mm-hmm. you can't be dismissive of anyone then either.
Exactly.
You can't say, you just don't have it.
Yeah. Right.
No, or no, does that happen?
No.
Okay.
I personally have never said that.
I also not. I feel like our pursuit is absolutely like on the opposite end of that. We try to purposely also look for people out there who always thought they were too weird to, you know, go to a school even, right? They'd be singled out if they ever went to an institution, and say, no, you come in here and take a few of our courses and see if this works for you, right? I think that, again, because I've through a documentary got to interview internationally a lot of filmmakers from all these countries. There's so many filmmakers that are not what you would think of as a traditional filmmaker. You'd look at them and go, oh, I would never imagine that you would work in film, maybe because you know, have an autistic issue or some type of other disability. And I was like, no, I mean, they found their way to do it. So I think that, like, really filmmaking can come from anyone. Whether that's a Ratatouille line or something like that, right? But I really think that it's possible. So you want to be, I think, create as much access as possible for people to be creative and find that outlet.
Inclusion is a good solution to a lot of our social issues.
Yeah. Oh, for sure. And for me, when you ask, do I know if they've got it when they walk into the classroom? And my answer would be, well, it's first of all, we do such a rigorous admissions process in RTA. We actually interview every candidate that comes in. So we typically have a good idea that this is good raw material, for lack of a better word. They do have the acumen for coming into our program. But for me, as the screenwriting teacher, as soon as I've read something of theirs, you can tell. You can almost tell in first year, you read their first pitch or you read their first assignment and you realize this student has something. They've got a way of their point of view in the world, whatever it is. It's there, and to me, that's when I can tell. It's getting some of the work done first, because that's really where it's going to be for me. I'm going to see if they've got that. Even if they can't construct a story the way that a pro could yet, that's something we can work on. But there's that spark, and you can see it in their pitch or in their writing.
Right. We only have about 2 minutes left, but I did want to say, do you let them know that they have that quality, or would that maybe interfere with the process?
No.
No.
You let them know and you nurture them, because in this industry, so many people are going to say no to you, and you don't want that voice to be extinguished. So I make it a priority that if someone has the talent, I let them know, and I say, you keep going, and they say, how can I do this? And I say, well, just do it. You know, mm-hmm. do it. Keep writing. I will read your stuff and I will comment on it. And we've had some successes come out of that.
That's why my friend's daughter, who takes a go to the Ryerson, says that you're one of the most popular professors on at Ryerson.
I don't say that to everybody. Too.
Yeah. Okay, best Canadian film. Who wants to jump in? Favorite Canadian film.
I want to say Porky's? No.
you could say Porky's. I'd have judged you.
Yeah.
This is only because I love the aspect of how this film connected and how this filmmaker arose. I suddenly am blanking on the name, but the movie was called Boredom. It was a short film.
Boredom.
And it was done actually with as part of the Jameson First Shot Challenge.
Yes.
And this was, you know, Kevin Spacey and Denon Brunetti, they were connecting with Jameson to basically allow aspiring filmmakers who are writer-directors to submit a script and direct it, right? And they got to work with an A-lister. So this Canadian got to work with Adrien Brody. And this was his, I believe it was his first, maybe his second short film ever, but, you know, he had done no other projects before. Other than that, and for myself, like, if anyone watches this and wants to check it out on YouTube, it's there. But it's so well done for the short time that he got to write and film it. That's the kind of filmmaker I like to see build more and do more with their projects.
Yeah. For me, always my favorite film is kind of one of the last ones I saw. So I saw just this week, and I'm also blanking on the name because I always do that at this moment. But Maudie?
Oh, Maudie.
Yes.
Yeah, very good.
I loved it. Just saw it this week, so it's fresh in my mind. Yeah.
And there's that one shocking moment with Ethan Hawkins. Ethan Hawkins. Yeah. Sally Hawkins, yes. Yes.
I'm going to go for an older film, not old, too old, but The Sweet Hereafter.
It's not beautiful.
Yeah, I mean, that was developed and made when I was at Alliance, and part of it is because I got to see the script go through so many different iterations during the process, and then every step of the way through the film. But even seeing it in the theater and knowing what the script was going to happen, I remember just being in the theater and just being completely overwhelmed by it. And I use it in class as a way to illustrate how certain structures of films can actually convey a lot more than what you think the typical three-act structure can do. So to me, it's just a beautiful combination of elements that came out into an amazing film.
And yes, and it's a multi-layered story too, with Sarah Polley's point of view and the lawyer's point of view, and it's just a beautifully told story. Yeah. Thank you so much for taking the time to join us. Michael from Ryerson University, Kathleen from Humber College, and Wilson from Rain Dance Toronto. Again, thank you so much. And thank you for tuning in to Making Movies Canadian Way. And remember, keep making movies because it is the Canadian thing to do.